Hello learners, myself Harish Kumar Tyagi. Today we are going to discuss the genesis of Indian education during pre-independence period. Under this topic, we are going to cover Charter Act, Wood Dispatch and Macaulay's Minutes. By the end of Vedic period and during medieval period, the missionaries and various religious groups had brought some basic education to the Indian masses through churches in English, in native temple schools through Sanskrit, and in madrasas using Persian and Arabic language. This was catering the needs of the few children with the support of contemporary rulers and charity of the rich till East India Company was established and British Parliament was involved. Under this Macaulay's Minutes, Macaulay wrote his famous Minutes in 1835, in which he criticized almost everything of India like astronomy, culture, history, philosophy, religion, etc., and praised everything of Western society. On the basis, he advocated the national system of education for Indian, which could best serve the interest of the British Empire. His Minutes was accepted, and Lord William Bentinck issued his proclamation in March 1935, which set at rest all the controversies and led to the formulation of a policy which became the cornerstone of all educational programs during the British period in India. Points of the controversy on the interpretation of Charter Act of 1813 and the national system of education and Macaulay's role. At the time, a major Oriental and Occidental controversy between the Orientalist and the Occidentalist was going on the respect of following issues. These issues were like whether it should be to educate the classes in higher branches of learning or to masses in elementary education, whether to preserve and promote Oriental learning, that is learning of the East, or to introduce Western knowledge, culture and science. Here, the medium of instructions, he says that it should be in English or Persian and Sanskrit or in Bengal, English or Indian languages in Bombay and Madras should become the medium of instruction. Agency of education was the government should assume direct responsibility of education, the Indians or the indigenous system of the country to continue, and the missionaries, whether the shores of India to be thrown open to the missionaries of all parts of world to promote education or to a few missionaries or not at all. Some extracts from the Macaulay's Minutes are like, he has clearly mentioned in his Minutes that we are to teach false history, false astronomy, false medicines because we find them in the company of false religion. For publishing the Indian books, he says that we are wasting public money for printing books which are of less than the value of the paper on which they are printed while it was blank. But he was even appraised, as the Minutes says, that in later to his in a letter to his father in 1836, Macaulay wrote, our schools are increasing with leaps and bounds, and how the condition has reached to a position that it has become difficult to accommodate the students. Hindus are much influenced with education. There is no Hindu who may keep real faith in the religion. After studying English, I have full confidence that if our education policy succeeds, then no admirer will be left in Bengal. All this will be done naturally without any religious preaching and interferences. That Macaulay was the torchbearer in the exaggerated claim. Lord Macaulay was not the first person who pleaded the cause of Western education and inspired the Indian people with ideas. He, of course, ended the controversy and gave a new direction to the system of education in India. A clear picture of this national system of education has emerged in its merits. The system proved very helpful in promoting the objectives for which it was planned. It also started to establish the English school, and English became that time the medium of instruction. Western arts, science became so popular, and also interestingly, a filtration theory of education was emerged. Again, we have the demerits also in the Macaulay system. Indian culture and philosophy moved away to the background. Vernacular language began to be neglected. Mass education was neglected. Western culture made rapid strides. Arabic and Sanskrit languages found very few takers. Arabic maktabs and Sanskrit pathshalas saw gradual disappearance. The clause of Charter Act of 1813 compelled the East India Company to accept responsibility for the education of the Indian people by granting 1 lakh rupees. Macaulay concluded that controversy by acquiring English language as a medium of instruction through his minutes. By introducing the English language for the education of Indian masses, Macaulay's opinion was that the public mind of Indian may expand under the English system, and through the English language, it may educate the people into a capacity for better government. Macaulay developed the policy of downward filtration theory, and through it, he made bifurcation of partiality in giving education to the Indian masses. Some people of higher classes in India and the East India Company appreciated Macaulay as a torch bearer in the path of progress. Lord William Bentinck passed the resolution of the Macaulay minutes on 7th of March 1813, where all the funds that were allotted for Indian education should be disbursed only in favor of English language. Now, we are going to discuss the Wood Dispatch. Wood Dispatch derives its name from Sir Charles Wood, who was the president of the Board of Control of India. It contained definite aim of education and directions for the implementation of education policy in India. The dispatch was prepared by 3 eminent English thinkers, namely Marshman, Perry, and Wilson. They made an intensive study of problems of education and thereafter prepared the scheme of education. The essence of these reports are that dispatch observed the system of science and philosophy which forms the learning of the East abounds with grave errors, and Eastern literature is at best very deficient as regards all modern discovery and improvement, and concluded the discussion with the following declaration: the diffusion of the improved arts, science, philosophy, and literature of Europe in sort of European knowledge. The main recommendations of the Wood Dispatch are to confer upon the natives of India those vast and material blessings which flow from the general diffusion of Western knowledge, not only to produce a high degree of intellectual fitness, but also to raise the moral characters of those who partake of the above advantages, to supply the East Indian Company with reliable, and to secure for England a large and more certain supply of many articles necessary for the manufactures and extensively consumed by her population. The medium of instruction was in English and in the vernacular language as per the Wood Dispatch. And it has been mentioned that in any general system of education, English language should be taught where there is a demand for it. But such instruction should always be combined with a careful attention to the study of the vernacular language of the district. And with such general instructions as can be conveyed through that language, and while the English language continues to be made use of as by far the most perfect medium for the education of those persons who have acquired a sufficient knowledge of it to receive general instruction through it, the vernacular language must be employed to teach the far larger classes who are ignorant, for the imperfectly acquainted with English, the translation of English literature, the vernacular literature of India would be gradually enriched by translation of European books, by the original composition of men whose mind have been imbued with the spirit of European advancement, so that European knowledge may gradually be placed in this manner within the reach of all classes of the people of India. Granting aid was also discussed in Wood Dispatch, and it recommended the sanction of a granting aid system in Indian education system. To educate the larger number of people of India was a difficult task, and so the granting aid system was adopted by the government. Grants were given to those schools and colleges which satisfied the conditions given below. Number one, the school must provide secular education. Number two, the school management should run the school well. Number three, the school should agree to state inspection from time to time. Number four, the school should follow any rule prescribed by the government for the regulation of the grant. Number six, the school must charge fees from the students for which they are coming to learn. And again, in this dispatch, the system of women's education has been discussed, that government should always support education for women. The Wood Dispatch stated that dispatch also encouraged the private enterprises to promote girls' education and women's education. It has clearly stated that the importance of female education in India cannot be overrated or overlooked. And we have observed with pleasure the evidence which is now afforded of an increased desire on the part of many of the natives of India to give a good education to their daughters. By this means, a far greater proportional impulse is imparted to the educational and moral tone of the people than by the education of men. The schools for girls were to be included among those in which grants in aid would be given. And again, it has focused on the training of teachers. It has recommended the establishment of teacher training schools in each of the provinces. There should be training school for teachers of engineering, medical, law, and so on. The qualified teachers should be given better pay scales. The dispatch further emphasized on the provision of scholarship to the students and also the teachers during their training period. Professional education, it has also emphasized on the professional education, and it recommended the establishment of medical, engineering, law, and other institutes for the professional education. The dispatch stated that in order to develop vocational efficiency of people and also to make people realize that the British rule was progressive, another reason for the encouragement of vocational education was to control the problem of unemployment. And introduction of network of graded schools all over the India was also in Wood Dispatch recommendations. It started a network of graded school all over the country. At one end were the universities and the colleges, then the high schools followed by the middle schools and bottom of the middle schools, and at the network were the primary schools. Both government and indigenous schools were there. Both the Anglo vernacular and vernacular schools were to be included in the same classes. This system was recommended in order to enable an individual to receive higher education after completing the different levels of school education. The merits of the dispatches are, it clearly laid down the educational policy, it made the government responsible for education, it gave direction in almost all areas of education at various levels, it promoted the girls' education, and it prepared the blueprint of the administrative setup of education. It also accepted the importance of Indian culture, literature, and philosophy. It gave due importance to the vernacular languages. It stressed the importance of training of teachers. and it stressed the importance of other parts of the schools. It pointed out the necessities of raising the salaries of teachers. It drew attention to the girls' education and to the poor deserving students. It emphasized the need of opening universities in India, and again there were certain demerits also in the dispatch. As we can say, it glorified Western knowledge at cost of Indian culture and philosophy. It tried to destroy the philosophy of India and its culture. It encouraged the spread of English, as it recommended that the newly educated person would be given preferences in government services. Religious education, which was an integral part of indigenous education, was always discouraged. It reflected a soft attitude towards Christian missionaries. Granting aid system was defective. Those institutions that could not raise 50% of their own resources were not eligible to get the grant in aid. Education became an instrument for passing examination for the sole purpose of securing a job, and still we are working on it. Bureaucracy has become the supreme in the running of the education system. Foreign university pattern came into vogue. Bookish knowledge was encouraged. But again, we have seen the impact of Wood Dispatch. By and large, recommendations of the Wood Dispatch were adopted. Departments of public instructions, education, particularly education departments, were abolished. All the provinces for them were open. There was increase in grant in aid. Religious naturality in education was observed. Professional education was encouraged. 3 years after Wood Dispatch, there was the 1857 revolt, which brought about far reaching change in the political scenario of India. The dispatch is also known as the Magna Carta of education. So we have to see whether it was a Magna Carta or not. The term, as we know, the Magna Carta denotes an official document or the policy of the government, which shows the guarantees on certain rights and privileges. A perusal of the various provisions contained in the dispatch does not provide any evidence for calling it Magna Carta of education. It fell short of expectations. The authors of the dispatch did not aim at education for leadership. It failed to provide for any plan for the industrial regeneration of India. In fact, it visualized India as a market for supplier of raw materials to Britain and a consumer market for the purchase of finished goods of Britain industries. Thus, its vocational policy was lopsided. Accordingly, it neglected the all-round development of the children of the individuals. The dispatch did not refer to the ideal of the universal literacy. It did not recognize the obligations of the state to educate every child before a certain age. Nevertheless, dispatch was an important educational document in the then prevailing situation. It would not be quite relevant to compare the dispatch with the scenario of the 21st century. The dispatch has to be evaluated in the context of 19th century. It was meant to serve the end of the British rulers. Thus, it was neither a Magna Carta nor a document without any utility. It must be admitted that since 1757, it was the most outstanding document on education. Wood Dispatch was of great significance. For the first time, a comprehensive scheme which touched the education on various vital points was presented through this Magna Carta. Let us sum up the Magna Carta. The main objectives of the Wood Dispatch was to educate Indian people in order to create a class of civil servants. Importance of training of the teachers was realized by the dispatch. And it also suggests the improvement of working condition and salaries of the teacher. The Wood Dispatch also encouraged professional education. Now, we are going to discuss the Hunter Commission. This commission came in 1882, and Hunter Commission was appointed by the British government to review the progress of education in the country. after the vote dispatch. Hunter Commission was set up in 1882, as we know, under the chairmanship of Sir William Hunter. It encouraged the indigenous system of education. This commission emphasized its recommendations on primary and secondary education. An attempt was also made on the diversify school curriculum and introduce vocational education system. It has certain merits, like it accepted the importance of primary education and gave detailed recommendations on the improvement of its various aspects. It evolved a systematic system of grant in aid. It provided encouragement to the indigenous system of education. It gave encouragement to private initiatives. It recommended diversified courses at secondary levels. It attached importance to the spread of women education, and it also has done so many things by introducing the new ideas under this British Raj. The commission recommended the reorganization of the university administrations. It also gave its recommendation of its commissions on secondary schools were brought under the control of the university. Under the Indian Universities Act in 1944, schools had to be reorganized by the universities, and rules and regulations were framed for these purposes. The Sadler Commission, we are going to discuss the conditions of the Sadler Commission and its recommendations. The next important development was realization of the need of improvement of secondary education for the improvement of the university education, as observed by the Sadler Commission in 1917. This concern also stemmed from of the need of bifurcation of college courses. Sadler Commission suggested bifurcation of higher education at the intermediate examination rather than at the matriculation examination, and suggested creation of intermediate colleges which would provide instruction in arts, science, medicine, engineering, teaching, and so on. The Sadler Commission report was a very comprehensive one, and many of the universities in India implemented its suggestions. It was also for the first time that a commission had recommended the attachment of intermediate classes to the high schools and the setting up of the board's education to the control high school and intermediate education. Now, we are going to speak about Hartog Committee. This committee was established in 1929, and the position of education in that country was of matriculation of the university still dominated in the whole of the secondary courses. To remove this defect, the committee recommended that a large number of students attending to follow the certain vocational should stop at the middle school stage, and there should be more diversified curricula in the school. The committee also recommended diversion of the more boys to industrial and commercial careers at the end of the middle stage, where they should be prepared for specialized education in technical and industrial schools. The committee also reviewed the problems relating to the trainings of teachers and the service conditions of the secondary teachers. Now, we are going to highlight the recommendations of SAPRU committee. This committee, appointed in 1934 by the Uttar Pradesh government to inquire into the causes of unemployment in Uttar Pradesh, and it came to the conclusion that the system of education prepared pupils only for examinations and for the degrees and not for education at all. It suggested that diversified course at the secondary stage should be introduced, one of these leading to the university degree, the intermediate stage be abolished, and the secondary stage be extended by 1 year. The vocational training and education should begin after the lower secondary stage, and the degree course at the university should extend over a period of 3 years. Now, we will highlight the recommendations of Abbot Wood report. In this report, more emphasis was given on the polytechnic system. This resolution came in 1935 of the Central Advisory Board of Education and two experts, advisors, messers. Abbot of Woodward, invited in 1936 to advise the government, particularly on the problems of vocational education. The Abbot Wood report, submitted in 1937, suggested a complete hierarchy of vocational institutions parallel with the hierarchy of the institution imparting general education. As a result of their recommendations, a new type of technical institutions called the polytechnic came into the existence. The provinces also started technical education, commercial education, agricultural education at their high school levels, and it also gave its recommendation that this type of education, that is polytechnic education, should be started in each province. Now, we are going to discuss the Jakir Hussain Committee's report, that is also known as the Wardha scheme. This scheme came in 1937, when the provincial governments were formed in 7 provinces with the native representations. They concentrated their attention on the educational reforms. In October 1937, an All India National Educational Conference was held at Wardha, and the conference resolved to accept the proposal made by Mahatma Gandhi that free and compulsory education be provided till 7 years of the age. The conference expected that this system of education will be self-sufficient, gradually will be able to cover the remuneration of teachers. The main features of the schemes were like the entire education is to be imparted through some industry or vocation with the basic craft as the center of instruction. Every individual should learn to earn, means while the child is learning, he has to do certain tasks so that he can have certain earning also. And learning is closely coordinated with home, community, and the child's life activity. If the child is engaged in the farming at home, so this type of learning to a child should be provided. This philosophy had a strong impact on the formulation of the educational policy, particularly at the elementary stage. And for free primary education to find place in the constitution of free India. The Sargent Committee, we are going to discuss here, so it gives its recommendation on the universalization of elementary education, and CAB, that is known as Central Advisory Board of Education, prepared a comprehensive report on educational development after the World War, known as the Sargent Report, and it came in 1944. It visualized a system of education with pre-primary education for children between 3 to 6 years of age, universal, compulsory and free primary basic education for all children between 6 to 11, that is junior basic, and 11 to 14, that is senior basic, is suggested in Wardha scheme. The senior basic of middle school to be the final stage in the middle schools and the school's career of the majority of the students. The report also recommended that at the middle school stage, provision should be made for a variety of courses. These courses should be designed to prepare the pupil for entry into industrial, commercial occupations as well as into the universities. The merit of the Sargent report was to that first comprehensive scheme covering all stages and aspects of education, that is primary, pre-primary, high school, university education, as well as technical, vocational and professional education. It provided for equal opportunity to all students. Due importance was given to the teaching profession, improvement of the salary scales and the service conditions of the teachers were also suggested in this scheme. It gave importance to the productive education and appreciated the employment problem in the country and thought that the education could provide solution to it. The recommendations provided the sound footing for the education in free India. Let us sum up. Education was imparted in gurukuls, which were mostly located slightly away from the habitations. The guru used to treat all students equal, irrespective of their status in the society. The guru was considered as the custodian of the education of each student. Teaching was mostly oral, a dialogue between the teacher and taught. Lectures, discussions, debate, recitations were part of the life of the students. It continued the need of during the medieval period also. At that time, maktabs and madrasas were established for Muslims students. And this education was being imparted in the mosque. Islamic education was also being provided by the mullahs and maulvis. Further, in this lecture, we have also discussed the recommendations of Hunter Commission, and it has given its recommendations that everywhere the education should be provided technically, and it should have certain impact so that every person could have certain skills and he should be trained in the professional skills and professional knowledge so that he can be have the sound knowledge, sound skills, and could earn himself and could not be continue as an unemployed. So in this way, many commissions were set up to strengthen the capacity of the people, of the individual, of the student, so that while they are learning, this can earn. So this was the main aim of the then commissions and the reports. Dear learners, so far we have discussed Wood Dispatch and the various commissions set up during pre-independence periods. So dear learners, we will meet in next lectures and discuss the rest part after independence. And till then, thanks and have a good day.